Artificial intelligence, or AI, is seemingly everywhere today. In fact, I'm willing to bet that the vast majority of the audience here tonight has recently interacted with AI. For example, if you performed a Google search on the internet or used a digital assistant such as Siri or Alexa, then you have been interacting with AI. In these and many other ways, AI is making our lives easier and driving economic growth. And yet, when I say AI, it probably also inspires some fear and anxiety. For example, some of you may think of the sentient HAL 9000 computer from 2001, A Space Odyssey, which was nice at first, but ultimately turned on its human crew. Or perhaps you think of the Terminator and an army of humanoid robots that are going to wreak havoc and ultimately compete with humanity for global domination. Or perhaps you've been convinced by Elon Musk that a digital god is already among us, and it's just a matter of time before we all become subservient to it. You may even be worried that I am going to use AI to exaggerate the size and enthusiasm of the crowd at my TEDx talk. Even if those doomsday scenarios don't scare you, there are other more acute issues being introduced by AI, ranging from compromised privacy to deep fakes to job displacement. For example, do we really still need English teachers when students can have their essays written by ChatGPT? Do we really still need Hollywood writers when screenplays can be produced using generative AI? These apparent problems with AI may lead you to believe that this technology is too dangerous, that somehow we need to stop it in its tracks and shut it down. But I would contend that the AI genie is already out of the bottle. And as a result, we have no choice but to confront the challenges that it is going to pose for us in the years to come. But for me personally, what keeps me up late at night, what keeps my team at Northwestern University working long hours in the lab, is a threat that is even greater. And that threat is energy consumption. By 2027, just 3 years from now, AI is going to be consuming 100 trillion watt hours of electricity each year, which is equivalent to the amount of electricity used by an entire country the size of Argentina. The energy demands of AI has even led Microsoft to begin hiring nuclear engineers who are seriously contemplating building nuclear reactors to power each of their AI data centers. And the problem doesn't end there. When you're dissipating 100 trillion watt hours of energy, you generate an immense amount of heat, which needs to be cooled by an immense amount of water to the tune of 200 billion gallons per year. In a world where 2.7 billion people live with water scarcity, the energy and water demands of AI are simply unsustainable, if not inhumane. And so is there any hope? Is there any way that we can overcome this apparent existential threat that AI poses? As a nanotechnologist for the last 25 years, I strongly believe that by understanding matter at the shortest of length scales, we can find solutions to the world's largest problems. What we're asking in our lab is, can we use nanotechnology to produce an alternative hardware platform for AI that will be much more energy efficient than a conventional digital computer? And while I will get into the nanotechnology details in a minute, what I want to focus on first is why current computing technology is so energy hungry, particularly for AI. For that, I want to introduce you to John von Neumann. In the first half of the 20th century, John von Neumann worked at the Institute for Advanced Study, the same institute as Albert Einstein and Robert Oppenheimer, where he became one of the most influential mathematicians of all time. And while his work has touched many fields, I would contend that the implications of his work for computer science are the most profound. Today, virtually every computer worldwide utilizes the von Neumann architecture, which consists of two major components, a memory and a central processing unit, or CPU. And when you perform a computation, data needs to move back and forth between these two units. For the past 60 years, when the amount of data was small, that motion of data led to negligible power consumption. But in today's big data AI world, we're moving massive amounts of data back and forth, leading to intolerably high power consumption, which means that we either need to have dedicated power plants for each of our AI data centers, or we need to rethink the von Neumann architecture. So are there any plausible alternatives? In our lab, we're looking to biology for inspiration. The basic idea is as follows. If AI is trying to mimic intelligence, then would it not stand to reason that we should look to the hardware platform for human thought, i.e. the brain, as an inspiration for next generation computing? That may sound like a sensible idea, but it would only truly make sense if the brain was much more energy efficient than a digital computer. To explore that question, I want to introduce a very famous example from artificial intelligence, the fact that a supercomputer can now beat a grandmaster at the game of chess. And while that is an impressive feat of AI, let's consider the energy required by the two opponents in this game. Let's first consider Garry Kasparov, the chess grandmaster. To fuel his game of chess, he needs one Chicago-style hot dog. In contrast, the supercomputer requires the equivalent of 250,000 Chicago-style hot dogs, which is the number of hot dogs sold at Wrigley Field over the course of an entire month of the baseball season. The remarkable energy efficiency of the brain is why my lab is pursuing neuromorphic, i.e. brain-like computing, as a pathway to energy-efficient AI. So how does the brain do it? How is it so energy efficient? Well, the key reason is that in the brain, memory and information processing are co-located in space, thereby minimizing the need to move data, thereby avoiding the main source of power consumption in the von Neumann architecture. In addition, the brain is three-dimensional, dynamic, reconfigurable, and highly interconnected, all of which further contribute to its extreme energy efficiency. So, is it possible to emulate those attributes of the brain in computer hardware? In our lab, we're turning to nanomaterials for the solution. The key feature of a nanomaterial is that it is very small. And when the size of a material approaches the atomic length scale, its properties become highly tunable and reconfigurable using an electric field. This implies that our nanoelectronic devices can be reconfigured on demand, thereby mimicking the dynamic reconfigurability of the brain. So what? Well, what that implies is that now in our lab, we have nanoelectronic devices that can perform AI-based machine learning at a factor of 100 lower power consumption than a digital computer. That ultra-low power... Oh, thank you. That ultra-low power consumption means that we can now do AI directly on portable electronic devices like a smartphone. In contrast to current technology, where the data on your smartphone needs to be sent to the cloud. But what is the cloud? The cloud is an energy-hungry, warehouse-sized data center. Using this technology, we've been able to develop a wearable electronic device that can monitor your heartbeat. And then using on-chip AI-based machine learning, we can detect if you have an arrhythmia or an irregular heartbeat. That has an advantage not only from a power consumption perspective, but also a privacy perspective. Because now your personal health data resides under your control on the wearable, as opposed to being sent to the cloud where who knows what happens to it next. And while this is an important step forward, I want to stress that we are doing the most rudimentary form of AI. What we ultimately want to achieve is sophisticated AI, AI that can begin to emulate cognitive function. For that loftier goal, I'm very happy that I live in the city of Chicago. a city that embraces a culture of interdisciplinary collaboration. For example, my building on the Evanston campus houses both engineers and neurobiologists. And as a result, we can take the latest advances in neuroscience and apply them to our next generation neuromorphic computing designs. What we're learning from this work is that the brain is not a homogeneous entity. It is highly heterogeneous, with different subsystems, each with their unique architecture that enables the diversity of human thought. This is in stark contrast to silicon electronics, where the paradigm has always been to take the exact same device, the transistor, and pack more and more of them into the integrated circuit. For biorealistic neuromorphic computing, we don't want to have a lot of the same device. We want to have many different devices, each of which can be dynamically reconfigured on demand. Our nanoelectronic devices are the foundation for that future. And so only one question remains. How quickly can we move from a university prototype to a widely deployed technology in the real world? Well, it's always a bit tricky to give a precise date on when we'll deliver that. But what I can tell you is that nanotechnology is now at the point where it is evolving rapidly, and importantly, in a way in which it can be commercially scaled. And as a result, I'm optimistic that energy-efficient AI can be delivered in time before we run into the nefarious consequences of conventional AI. In particular, by combining neuromorphic computing with renewable energy and batteries for grid-level storage, I believe that we can achieve sustainable AI. Sustainable AI that can be delivered equitably throughout society. This is the future that I dream of. And I hope you agree, it is also an idea worth spreading. Thank you.